Today I'm going to do a little video on how you remove and replace the Toyota locking hub. This would be the Toyota locking hub right there. We've got a pretty good candidate. I don't know if that thing's ever been off, judging by the amount of rust I'm seeing on the nuts right there. The tools that you need, if you want to do it correctly, would be a 10 millimeter on preferably a quarter drive to take off the hub dial bolts. They're pretty small and delicate. Then you're going to need a deep drive 12 millimeter on, I'm using a 3/8 drive, a pair of snap ring pliers, and I would recommend finding some that have the flat bill like that. It'll really help you get that snap ring off, as you'll see in the video. A pick tool, a pair of 12 millimeter box wrenches, a brass drift, a 3-pound sledge, and a torque wrench for when you go to put it all back together. Okay, so first things first, we got to get off the six bolts that are holding on the hub dial. This would be your hub dial. Now, you know, I have never had a problem with these Toyota hubs, ever. I've sure had a lot of these trucks, double digits at least. I think I'm up to 14 or 15 of these things now. Anyway, you see a lot of guys replacing the Toyota hubs with worn hubs, and I love worn products. They make great winches and stuff, but I don't think their hubs are superior to the Toyota hubs. Generally, if you've got a Toyota hub that's not working, it's because somebody assembled the inside of it incorrectly, and that'll be the subject of another video, but you have to assemble the spring and clutch mechanism exactly right, or what'll happen is the hub will go back together, you'll stick it in, you'll turn the dial, and it'll go in, but then it won't retract. After you move all six bolts, put it in the free position. You can lock it in the free position, and then simply pull that out of here. Now, I haven't ever had this off. This truck is just going to be parted out, so we'll see what we get here. Pretty nasty. Looks like there's a lot of grease and gear oil and probably water all mixed in there. And now, what we've exposed by taking off the hub dial is the snap ring. It is actually on the end of the burr field, the joint that turns in there, and you can see that snap ring. Now Toyota uses a snap ring that has pointed ends on it, so a standard snap ring plier isn't going to work very well. That's where this duck billed looking snap ring, and I got this at Sears I think for 10 bucks years and years ago. But that's where this thing really shines, is it's got flat surfaces, so you can just reach in there, grab that snap ring and pull it right off. And let's see if I can clean that up here. And you can see how that snap ring has got sharp edges on it, which just makes it a little tricky to get off sometimes with a regular pair of snap ring pliers. It's time to remove the six nuts that are on the studs that hold the locking hub body to the actual wheel hub. So that's where you take your 12 mil on your deep drive 12 mil and just break them loose a little bit. And what we're going to do is you're going to run the nuts just out far enough so that you are flush with the end of each of the studs. Now, you get a lot of these Toyota trucks, and you can tell when somebody, a prior owner's been working on them who didn't know what they were doing, because you'll start seeing a lot of hammer marks around the outside of the hub body. Don't ever hammer on the outside of the locking hub body. It'll bend, it'll tweak, it'll cause you all kinds of grief. I'm going to show you how to get these things off. So what you've got is you've got your nut, you've got a split washer, and then that thing underneath there is a cone washer. The cone washer is tapered, obviously a cone, and that's what holds this thing on. So the body just won't pull off until you release pressure on those cone washers. So now what you want to do is you get your brass drift and your 3-pound sledge, and you're going to hit, you want that nut all the way up here so that you're not going to booger up the threads, and you're not going to, you want to hit basically the top of the stud and the nut at the same time, and the shock will usually pop that cone washer loose. Let's see if I can get one. Obviously, you want to put your safety glasses on. There it goes. I can see it pop. You can actually watch the cone washer and see it when it pops off. As soon as you see it pop up out of there, go ahead and unscrew the nut, take off that, and if you're lucky, you'll be able to get the cone washer right off of the stud. A lot of times they're kind of seized on there, and you'll end up having to use the pick or, you know, hit everything else first. But there's the three parts of each of those studs: the nut, the split washer, and the cone washer. When you reassemble this stuff, it's a great idea to put a little dab of grease just around the cone washer so that if you ever come back to disassembly, it's nice and easy. So, do the rest of them. There it goes, I can see it. Once you've done a couple of them, you can really tell by just looking at, as you're hitting it, you can see when that cone washer just pops and releases. Oh, and these are actually pretty good, so that one's a little bit stuck on there. You can kind of take the pick at that point and stick it into the slot and spin it a little bit, see if you can get it. There it goes. Sometimes they get just jammed up a little bit. Let's see. We'll just leave. Oh, there it goes. Almost. Sometimes a pair of pliers helps. Got it. But yeah, we're just going to go around the rim and pop all of those like that. Now, I probably should, in the spirit of full disclosure, tell you that a couple hours before coming out here to do this, I shot each of these studs, nuts, and bolts with a little bit of PB Blaster penetrating spray to help loosen them up, because I'd never taken this one off before and I had no idea how seized on there it was. It really wasn't bad as far as they go. Now, I also should mention that I'm on the West Coast, so we don't have nearly the problems that the guys on the East Coast do with salt in the roads and other stuff. So I've never had the brass drift method not work for me. I've always been able to get them off that way, but I could potentially see where if it was really salt corroded, it might be just hard as hell to get those things off. Anyway, it worked out great. A little penetrating spray never hurts. Help loosen up those cone washers and threads and such. So, at this point, go ahead and just grab the body and pull it off. Now, depending on how the prior owner did it, you might have to get a rubber hammer or something and tap the sides to help loosen it up. This one's just going to fall right off. And boy, this one's ugly. You can tell that it's just a goopy mess, and the inner axle seals must be shot because it looks like we get a nice little mix of gear oil and other junk here. But it looks like the old gasket's still there. So that's how you get the hub off. And we'll go on to the next step, which is going to be checking the studs. One of the big problems you're going to see with the Toyota hub is these studs will work themselves loose over time. I mean, this truck's a 1981, so it's 2011. This thing's 30 years old. So these hubs have been in here, or these studs have been in here a long time, and they're probably, you know, they've probably reached the end of their life. It wouldn't hurt to go buy new studs and put them in, but at a minimum, you should check the studs to see if they're in there tight. If I was doing a full rebuild on this thing, I would pull each of these studs, clean them off real good, and then reassemble them with a bit of Loctite in there and let them sit overnight and harden up before I put the body back on. But at a minimum, you can check them. So take two of the nuts that you took off and run them down and back them against each other so that they're good and tight. They're jammed against each other. And then take the outside nut and try to turn. And wow, that whole stud just turned about an eighth of an inch. Well, an eighth of a turn. So what I like to do is I'll just keep turning until the stud doesn't turn anymore. Still turning a little bit. That thing's pretty loose. And boy, that thing's really loose. My goodness. Wow, that thing is super loose. Yeah, that stud shouldn't be turning much at all. Boy, it's really loose. Kind of scary. That's one of the premature It's one of the ways these things can die a premature death is if the studs all get loose like that and it starts letting the hub dotty walk around in there. So tighten that thing back down. Okay, that's pretty good. And like I said, if I was doing a full rebuild, I'd pull each of these studs. Same method, tighten the nuts together and then use the back one, and you can walk the stud right out of there, clean everything up, put a drop of Loctite, and run it back down like I did here by jamming nuts together and then using the outside one. Once you're tight, go back to your inside nut and tighten it one more little stroke down, and that'll loosen the two. That'll loosen the two nuts away from each other, so then you can just undo the outer. And at this point, you've done nothing that would loosen the stud, so it stays in its tightest position. And you want to do that all the way around the ring, just to make sure everything is as tight as it can possibly be. Take the hub body, and you can match. You got to match up the hub body with the pinholes. There's two little pin studs in addition to all your threaded studs, and so you match the pinholes there, so it can really go on. There's only two possible combinations that can go on. Smack it down smooth. Take a cone washer, put your cone washer on, put your split washer on, and do that all the way around the rim. Now, I would have also cleaned all these split washers and put a little drop of lube on them and stuff, but we're just doing a quick demo here, so. And then go ahead and put your nuts on each of the studs. I'd say more of these hub failures could be attributed to the studs working themselves loose than anything else. Most of the, like I said, I've never actually had a hub failure on the Toyota ones. I've had buddies with big tires and stuff have failures, but it's usually the inside, this piece here exploding. You can get aftermarket ones of these made by Bobby Long up at Longfield Super Axles, which are way stronger and pretty much eliminates that problem. But even more so than that would be just making sure all those studs are tight. You can also get aftermarket studs that are made out of much better material. I just recommend getting brand new studs if you're seriously rebuilding one of these axles, and you should be fine. After you get all of these nuts put back on, it's time to grab your torque wrench. Factory calls for 21 to 25 foot-pounds on each of those. So I usually just kind of split the difference and go with 23. So at 23 foot-pounds, it isn't very much, but I'm a big fan of torque wrenches just for sake of accuracy. And now, don't forget to put your snap ring in. Sometimes the burr field in there will walk around a little bit. You can see you can move the burr field in and out a little bit. There's a little bit of play in there. It's supposed to be there. That's okay. But you can pull it out a little ways so you can actually get to the snap ring hole. And then, again, I just love these duck-billed snap ring pliers. Put it in, spread it. Make sure the snap ring actually gets in the groove. You can just take your finger in there and verify, and then push in. And that's all done. And then reinsert your locking hub dial. And on this, you'll notice that there's some fat grooves here and here. That's because there's a couple of teeth in the body here that need to correspond with those grooves. Otherwise, it won't go back together. Here it is. So, I mean, it can only, again, this thing can only go on one of two ways, basically. So if you're trying to put it on like that and it won't go, it's because you need to line up the groove correctly. And then just put your six bolts with the 10 millimeter heads on. Now these things are so small, that's why I like to use the quarter drive wrench on them, because these are so easy to over torque and snap off, and they really just need to be snug. But if you do snap one off, just take the rest of them off and then pull the dial cover, and then it should expose enough of it where you can grab it with a pair of pliers, or worst case scenario, get your Dremel tool out and carve a slot in it and use a screwdriver to back them out. But just run them down till they're like so, flush. So take your quarter drive then and just snug everything up real good. Don't go crazy so you don't break something off. But once you do that, check your dial, make sure it goes between free and lock, and you can, if you got a good ear, you can hear the mechanism in there going backwards and forwards, and you're back on the trail. Toyota does have a gasket under this part and a gasket under this part. They're generally reusable as long as you don't tear them. If you do, they're cheap and easy from Toyota, a couple of bucks each probably. Anyway, I hope you enjoyed it, and I hope you learned something, and we'll see you on the trail.